E agora com vocês, a arquiteta que não precisa de apresentação, Zaha Hadid.
Is it possible to adjust the light because it's too bright? Thank you very much. I would like to also introduce Patrick Schumacher. Patrick. Who is the partner in the office and responsible for many of the recent work and some of the old work. I was in Mexico City before I came to Rio, and I feel as if I've been in a traffic jam for the past 2 weeks. I forgot that Rio is so dense. Patrick. Next, please. These are maybe those who followed my career will remember some of these drawings. This was called The World, and showing on the surface the series of projects which we did almost 30 years ago for an exhibition in London. Is this okay, the microphone? Yeah, okay. Next, please. It's really also very nice to be back here because when I was a student, I wanted very much to come to Brazil. And later, when I was teaching, I also wanted to come to Brazil, and in particular, I wanted to visit Oscar Niemeyer. And I had met him a few times, but I was very lucky to visit him for a short period of time yesterday, and was he had some encouraging words, and it was very nice to see him. These are also projects which are to do with the city. This is the idea of the roof landscape. Next. Also drawings, how these kind of graphic representations really became a real project. One of the very early projects which had to do with the idea of the ground, or separating or multiplying the ground, was also maybe lessons from Brasilia, how the multiplicity of ground can create more than one level of public and civic domain. Grand buildings, the idea of disbursement of the tower or the cluster as an ensemble, which also is something which we developed also over the years with the five towers and one slab behind. The analysis of the city, how certain sections become new towns, and the studying London and focusing on East London, which of course now is a site for the Olympics. These are kind of very sketchy drawings for Barcelona, but for a master plan, but it was what occurred in this work was this idea of shifting lines, which became the precursor for the Vitra Fire Station. Next, please. Again, the idea of distortion, the idea of the carve or carving spaces in the city create a public domain, buildings which float above a certain datum. So you can create a density which is not excluded, but it actually operates differently on every single datum of the city, and seeing it from different perspectives. Master plan for Vitra. Next. And this is a study which was done almost 20 years ago for Madrid, analyzing the city, and one of the early graphic representation of what we call striation, and how striation, and also liquid morphologies, how we analyze the city, and how from the very kind of small concentric centers, the city can explode towards and kind of a corridor. In this case, it was the airport. Next. These kind of series kind of also flocks of buildings in different cities, like in London and places like that. Next. So I'll go through different, let's say, topics. The series of master plans, I think I might have a pointer, but yeah. This is a master plan for a project in Singapore, where the whole master plan is based on a series of hubs, but it's a topography, so it's a kind of an invented topography as an urbanism with the streets in between, and the buildings could vary from quite low to very tall according to the kind of mountain ranges which you can provide. We left where that existed in the side, which is a park, so the park becomes almost like a kind of a reservoir or a river within this master plan. This is a project in China where there's kind of a flock of towers, but when we began to look at this idea of multi kind of programmed use of each tower, so that each tower has a tail and the tail has public facilities. Another master plan for a project in Bilbao down the river, where you look at kind of variety of you know, ways of dealing with the master plan. This is for Istanbul, a quarry, which was part of the master plan as well. So there are four, five master plans being looked at. Next. So the idea of this one program in Singapore, which is a soft grid, so it this is an existing, obviously, site, and this is another one, and the idea that the lines in between can connect these two, mediate between the existing cities. Next. And this is kind of, that, again, back to the topography. These are the kind of existing site where you know, you have bridge building, which bridges the park. You have on the edge housing, and then these four different hubs, which are mostly to do with technology hubs. So the idea that the technology park is no longer about extruding towers, but in each case the campuses, like some of these things are mini campuses which could be connected through bridges. So can you form a cluster of many of these as one single kind of program? And again, the landscape of each of these undulates. Next. A study of all the blocks. We did not do any of the building, we just did envelopes and the master planning. So these are some of this kind of, let's say, cluster of projects, making it into a kind of ensemble of buildings done by other architects. But what we recommended is that they should be bridged, instead of one single building, but they're bridged to make the campus workable. Another study for a master plan in, we had done actually many studies many years ago on harbor developments, because it was an interesting thing, and it was very interesting for me to know that this harbor in Rio is also will be developed. This was on one edge of it is in a harbor. There's a new, kind of a newish airport, the Formula One track, but these are two cities disconnected in the middle because it was an industrial site, and the idea was to kind of create another kind of soft grid, next, which has these kind of almost like Cartesian block towers, which oscillate between perimeter blocks to towers as you move towards the coastline, next. The two existing cities and how they become connected and distorted with this new soft grid, and also they could become high rises. So it's the application of the soft grid and the topography with the idea of a, like, almost like a calligraphy installed on the side. The hollows or the kind of gaps are some of them is quarry, which existed, or maybe other public spaces which are carved away from the context. So we can do two activities. One, which is adding a new urban master plan and at the same time cutting away, carving public space. And this way of organizing the master plan gives you the possibility from very low rise or very small building to very tall buildings with a kind of variety of heights. So you can have a skyline in one end and lower buildings on the other to occupy the quarry, which already existed, where there may be kind of housing program or commercial. Next, please. Can we move on? These are other studies, kind of of an ensemble in the central business district in Beijing, where the idea of the cluster of many towers, but the towers themselves are made of other clusters. So it's kind of multiple clusters, so that you can to make a kind of a density of the tower itself, and also views, internal views of each of the towers. Then we go from master plans to sport master plans. This is a kind of youth Olympic project for Nanjing, where the idea of the master plan is also connected to stadia and the landscape, so it's one single project. Again, the idea that it's a kind of another topography over this one. Just some views of the stadia or the ski jump in Innsbruck, which was an interesting kind of project almost 10 years ago in the Alps, where one change was the requirements of the jump, the height change, so it required a new ski jump. But of course, the views from the top over to the mountains are quite stunning. This is one single kind of stretch. There's the Bergisel, where the stadiums are, where you watch, but you can also watch from the top. Next. And now a study of another football stadium. Oh, no, it's a stadium in Qatar. Just show us some of the interiors. It's an indoor stadium, so that the grass, the stadium has to kind of be rolled in and out. Or it could become a kind of a boxing competition. These are still under wrap. They're kind of a series of, let's say, aquatic pools, all clustered together. Also in the Middle East. And the way some of these things can lift off the ground to allow access to the site. The aquatic pool in London. This is the whole of the Lee Valley, the Olympic Park, the main stadium. Some of these kind of canals. The whole site has been under construction. This is the site, our pool, when it was still being finished. So kind of it's a single roof with 1 point landing and 2 points on the other end with the cantilever. This is how it would be in legacy. This product was designed what we call for legacy mode, and it will be it's been kind of refitted for the Olympics. It's like a pavilion in the park. There's a slight podium, There's a cantilever over the bridge with a transparency on both sides of the pool. The pool on the interior skin is all wood stripes, striation, which goes also to the exterior. And this is a structure with the two points on one end and one on the other, so it doesn't, so it allows, because of the requirement to extend the seating, it could not really land on the two sides, so it allowed to maximum seating. The seating is for 18,000 people during the Olympics and five afterwards. Just to show the wooden, with the wood interior. On the underside of the roof. This is under the bridge. This is the exercise pool. So it's made of, the pool is made of three pools. One which is an exercise pool under the existing, with a new bridge, with the roof lights coming through. So also give glass flooring on the roof. And then as you, the swimmers and the athletes changing, you see the view of the pool with the yellow are the extended seating, all concrete work, which is actually very nicely done. These are all the rooms for all the television and observers. The roof, which is like almost like, you know, swimming under a kind of sea life or a whale. Also, it's like a wave. The all the diving boards are made of kind of in situ concrete cask diving boards, so you're under the kind of roof. This is the view from the diving boards to the diving pool and beyond to the main pool. And the diving boards all cast in different heights. Last summer, they did a test 1 year to go of the main British diver, Tom Daley. These are different kind of master plans. Next. West Kowloon, which there's a whole area in Hong Kong where it would be developed as a kind of cultural hub or cultural facilities facing Hong Kong Island. Another master plan in Tianjin, also in China, for a cultural master plan with opera houses, museums, concert halls, and so on. Next. Another, again, cultural master plan for Changsha, which is going ahead. This is a master plan for residential or multi-purpose uses. This is the master plan for the opera house, which is in the middle, with different museums and schools, which will slightly change, but this is still the main opera house. A project which we did a long time ago, well, almost a few years ago now, for a very small extension in Copenhagen, outside Copenhagen. So the idea, there was very early work about the idea of the landscape as a project, and this is a landscape building within the landscape, so it's extension of an existing building. So you can have kind of really combine existing kind of older building with a new one, which is like a topography, and also with transparency, you can allow this building to become very perforated in the landscape. The museum in Cincinnati, which was a vertical museum, so in areas where you have, like the downtown, where you have less space, but you can actually have a museum which is stretched vertically like a tower. With a cluster of aggregates, so they have these things which kind of really cluster together to form a single building, but also it allows the people who work in the museum to have exterior to the of the building. The ground being always transparent to kind of indicate that this site is no longer a commercial site, but it's a kind of a public site, with what you call a move, which is to do with the idea of the urban carpet, where the wall, which goes all the way from the roof down, is a kind of continuation of the street. And these are some of the ramps, which are in the slit, taking you all the way up. Wolfsburg, which was another project for, as a museum, as a science museum, where the idea of dealing with idea of different scales, so you deal with the scale of the surrounding with the smaller spaces, and the idea of the very large plateau, which has all the exhibits. But the idea also was to kind of really, that you can occupy structure, so you create a kind of a cluster of legs, which also you occupy structurally, but you also occupy as a program. So in the night, this idea that the ground could be always animated with restaurants and theaters, and while the museum above, which is also another landscape, which is a science center. The Rome Maxxi, where it's a kind of, again, it's a series of streams. Rome was a very interesting situation. It was a kind of just on the outskirts of Rome and near the river, but the idea was kind of really, this is an existing building, this is not part of the site, but most of the site was kind of factories which were done in the 1904 and became more like barracks, military barracks. So the Ministry of Culture took over the site from the Ministry of Defense to make it into a cultural building, the first museum of contemporary art in Italy. There was no institution at the time. This is phase one, and so the idea that these streams kind of intersect and separate to form these various series of spaces, and also they're layered. So they're not only intersecting, but they're also layered like as if making kind of archaeology at the same time. And the striations are, you know, indication of the route which you can take, and also allows the light in. This is the entrance, but the room on the top is also a gallery. Next. So every side, because of the shift in geometry, every street on the surrounding can have a view of the building. So this is a by the entrance, under the area which steps down to the ground. So you see through, and then as you enter the main space with all the staircases connecting vertically and the roof at the entrance desk. So everything is white except the staircases are dark, black. The ceiling is also adjustable, so you can have the louvers or you can have it open and up or closed for kind of light control. This is at the opening where there's kind of a dance company which did a performance in the space. So all the kind of really the lines which connect like a walking in a hill town. These are very large ribs which you can also hang walls from or objects. And they see, you can see the layers of the spaces. The room above, which frames the existing landscape, seeing out all the lighting. And we are now looking at doing not the extension of the museum, but a project which starts here on the neighboring side. Next thing. So these are different kind of, can you go back? So this shows kind of these spaces which constantly intersect, the cantilever above, the gaps in between which form a series of courtyards. Next please. Different views of the ceiling and the main entrance. another museum, which was in Glasgow, on the intersection of two rivers, the Cavern and the Clyde, which is like a melted shed in memory of the existing sheds, which the shipbuilders, again, like a port, so in the shipbuilding sheds where they made these ships, and also they took all the trains to various parts of the British Empire. So it's a very kind of an extrusion, and it's cut off at the two ends, but in the inside, kind of you meander through, using a kind of a skin, which is for roofing, but you use it on the entire elevation. So it's a very kind of contained space. So it's kind of very efficient in terms of environment. There's the roofscape. The interior is all kind of lots of cars and buses and trains, bicycles. Is all to do with transport. So this exact roof stretches out, and you pull out till you reach the dock, where the last exhibit is that boat ship. Another very small museum pavilion, sort of Chanel, which was the idea of a temporary structure which could move around from one city to the other. It started off in Hong Kong on top of a car park, and then it went to Tokyo and New York. And Tokyo and New York City on this end. It's a kind of a tourist where you enter in one end and you come out on the other. Originally it was a kind of Chanel exhibit. The interior varies from fiberglass to fabric. It is now standing at the Arsène de l'Institut du Monde Arabe in Paris, so it's kind of it's a new resting place. Another pavilion, which is a bridge for the expo in Zaragoza, which is the structure is a kind of concrete structure in the base and a steel, suspended steel frame above with a concrete fiberglass kind of paneling. It's on two levels. So it acted both as a pavilion, as a bridge, and also as an entrance to the expo. All the different performance art centers. This is the Guangzhou Opera House diagram, kind of flow dynamics. It's a kind of two pebbles in the stream. We had to deal with the idea of the color of the pebbles, the idea of erosion. And so these are two eroded rocks nesting together, so nesting as well. And as they nest, kind of, they form these very narrow crevices between them. One is the opera house, and the other one is a multi-purpose hall. One is black on the outside, white on the inside. The other one is the reverse, white on the outside, black on the inside. It's a kind of a steel mesh structure, which is sometimes cladded by the stone or cladded in glass, on glass curtain wall, to allow transparency between the volumes and to see the interior. And it can have this seamless movement through a space as you enter from the park outside all the way through the building till you go to the theater. The main auditorium with the main stage. So the stage is also, the interior is like it has asymmetry. It's not kind of symmetrical auditorium. It's kind of all preformed in like gypsum, like an interior of an oyster, a kind of a gold champagne color, with all the lighting, all the air conditioning included, and the perforation of the actual skin. Like the relief, like some of these interiors of the for the rehearsal rooms. So all these studies which were done earlier, which are more like graphic studies of reliefs and striation, really are translated in a way into the interiors of some of these projects. So the dark interior with a kind of an orange door. So some of this kind of this mesh, this structural mesh, is cladded with the kind of material. Some of it's transparent, some of it stays as a mesh. There's different interpretation of the skin. Another performance art space, which is an opera house in Jordan. So the idea of quarrying comes back. The idea of the carve and quarrying and erosion as a kind of like carving away one single block to form this kind of almost amphitheaters in the interior of the building. And it's also operated as a window connecting the two sides of the city within the interior. So the theaters. Another project can be gone through this battery. In Rabat, another theater. The Performance Art Center in Abu Dhabi, which is part of the cultural district, which is where Guggenheim would be on one end. There were like three or four or five pearls. So this is the Guggenheim, the Jean Nouvel Louvre, and our Performance Art Center, and another museum there in the city. It's also triangulated site, similar to the idea of the site for the Olympics here, where on the edge in the water are these cultural buildings, which are obviously permanent facilities. So they operate as an attractor to people who could use that site commercially. And also for the performances and museums. So this is kind of a fluid cluster or like a fruit. So there are maybe six, seven concert halls or performance art spaces with a big concert hall right on the top. But on the inside, they kind of cluster together a series of theaters and so on. So dealing with the idea of density and compactness, and also a kind of a great figure on the water. All the different interiors of all the performance spaces. The Dubai Opera House, which is more like a dune, with the hotels and libraries, and again, it's a kind of very large space. But the idea to kind of really be inspired by the environment, which is like to do dune formations and how to deal with that as a kind of one single entity as a performance space. So this idea of really creating kind of, let's say, a peak in terms of kind of a spaces of performance. So this idea of the kind of dunes and the peaks kind of is maybe not directly translated into another project in Baku, in Azerbaijan, where there are three buildings, the library, which is the tallest peak, the performance, the like a concert hall, and the museum all clustered together in one single space, and we're sharing all the interiors as a kind of lobbying and stuff. It's on site. All the cladding is done in concrete fiberglass, fiber concrete. They are all done in actually Dubai, shipped, or Sharjah, shipped to Baku. Many, many tests of these kind of tiles formed and kind of really, they're not, most of them are not repetitive tiles. And so the idea was that the skin also flows into the ground, so it's kind of a seamless, the kind of the seamlessness is achieved through this continuous space from the landscape to the building as a landscape as it cascades down the side. These kind of opening like fins. Some of these lobby areas which connect all these three sides. A space frame which allows you enormous flexibility and light, cladded in this material. Enormous halls, all the entrance areas. Again, the distortion on the exterior and how it allows, also it allows you to bring in light to this enormous mass. Early studies of the actual theater. This is made of all, there's a real one. This is all made of laminated wood, again done in Turkey and shipped to Azerbaijan. So kind of similar to the exterior where it is kind of, you know, slit. Including all the lighting, so kind of, it's kind of seamless, a seamless world. We had done these diagrams many years ago for another project in Qatar, but this is kind of translated now to another opera house in Chengdu. So almost like two waves, two hills intersecting. And it's not a solid mass to achieve this lightness when we striated all the skin. So going through all the interiors and so on. This is the central building in Leipzig for the BMW. Can we run through this, Patrick? Where there are two volumes intersecting. It's kind of an interesting program, which was basically combining management with design and production. So blue-collar workers, white-collar workers, car manufacturing. Where the through the building, which is a standard building, runs all the cars from factory to storage to so on. So these are the belts for the cars which they move around, and then the actual idea for the workspace is a kind of a series of terraces, and which are open. So they are open on one hand, but on the other hand, because they're terraced, they have some sort of privacy between these decks. and looking at the car. So this idea of adjacency between manufacturing and management. So this idea of kind of clustering reappears as a kind of a landscape, an idea of erosion. So this is a kind of based on a tree, kind of tree of knowledge. So it's a building for a library, archive, and sport for the a region in Montpellier, for the region. And this is some of these final images. And this will open in the summer. So the area which is transparent is all the public areas. The areas which are solid are very robust, let's say, concrete, prefabricated concrete pieces. Some of them are theaters, and some of them are part of the storage of the archive and the library. So instead of doing three buildings, we did one. And the lines in between are all the kind of public, where the public could be, could go. Endless complements of lines, whether it's the curtain frames or the mullions or the louvers and so on. So I think it's interesting that the curtain wall begins to look again like some of these early diagrams and drawings, which are all this kind of soft grid begins to reappear as a kind of a fenestration. Some of these interiors with all the lighting. Another office space, which is based on a kind of soap bubbles, which is a cluster for an environmental campus. In Saudi Arabia. So some of these skins are also prefabricated fiberglass concrete. Some of them are transparent, or not, they are tensile. So you kind of, you're constantly in the shadow, but the level of kind of transparency changes. Studies of all the exteriors. Seen on site. There's obviously a tabula rasa, there's nothing there at the moment. The structure, a test of all the elevations. These are studies of many towers we've done. The one here is, this was almost on site, this dancing towers, signature towers. This is finished in Marseille. Again, back to the CBD, the cluster of towers with multiple voids. So they have a view of the interior and the exterior, like many towers, like a flower reaching out. Marseille, on the in the harbor, the one of the first buildings to be delivered on the harbor, with a kind of a double skin and curved on the ground. So this idea of the skirt reappears here. There's different kind of glazing in the middle and on the sides. It is between two motorways. So this side curves out to form the roof of an existing, of a new building, which is adjacent to this, which is more to do with kind of education. And this is kind of becomes very narrow between these two motorways. The exoskeleton skin, the structure, the bending of the structure. And of course the ground is the lobby. As you walk in, it's quite narrow because of this kind of tightness of the site, but it stretches out on the two ends. This is the connection between the bridge and the space for education. So the idea that with the tower, where, you know, it's kind of we many studied many options whether the tower should land in a point or should land in a kind of a flared up base. Next, many studies of a project in the central back in Baghdad. On the Tigris. So these kind of structure can also operate as a louvering device and a structural device, solid on the ground, and then as it moves up, it becomes more transparent. Exposing some of these elevators. I just move through it, please. These are this idea of the ensemble. So it's no longer a single tower, but a cluster of towers. But in this case, they kind of connect together. They share a structure and sometimes lifts. Just move through this part, please. Soho Galaxy, which is again a very large site in the central business district in Beijing. So the idea was, instead of again using a perimeter block, to make a series of kind of really a cluster of these very large objects which connect, like forming almost like a kind of ravine or a valley between them. So they have their internal kind of landscape and the exterior landscape. And on the section up to the point of the bridges, let's say, are all commercial, and then they go into offices. It's like a contour line dealing with all the balconies and the window elevations. And the bridges connect one place to the next, forming a kind of a semi-roof. So if you are inside, you can see all the layers of the building. So the idea for Soho China is that you can have a flexible space up to a certain point with all the shops, and then you can go into kind of really offices in this case. So they have an internal landscape, but also within each of these eggs, there's an internal kind of atrium. Also on site to be completed in a few months' time. No, can you skip this? I'm not showing it. Patrick, I need to rush because I'm in Eskimo land here. I'm frozen to death. I'm not sure what it's like out there, but here it's Antarctica. This is Patrick Schumacher's favorite project. It's a project for a client who wanted a house in the forest, but he thought it would be tragic if he lived down here and doesn't see the trees, so we put him up there. It's kind of like a private ski jump. I don't think, I mean, the only people who would jump out is those who the client does not like. Maybe the project architect. Not Patrick. Another guy in my office whom I don't like. Anyway, it's also cladded in a concrete frame, fiberglass concrete. So the space below on the ground is a kind of spas and living rooms, and above is the bedrooms. It's a very fit client. He's into sports, so he's going to be running up and down all the time. We're looking at all the interiors. Patrick trying to tell us it's a fireplace, in case we don't know. Okay, Patrick. I'm going to be here for I'll be an iceberg before you. Before you finish with me. Okay. Next. The bridge in Abu Dhabi, the third crossing. It was one of the first, this took a long time. It's a kind of a dune formation, the first of the idea of the dunes, where the structure starts on the outside and enters into the decks, which are 8 lanes. The deck is a mesh or a steel mesh. We designed all, but it took literally years to make. Next, can you move, please? This is a new project for a car park in Miami. Strasbourg, the car and ride, park and ride project. I'm showing these things because I think they're also relevant to Rio, where the idea of a tram and parking outside the outskirts of the city, made of really two materials, concrete and tarmac, black and white, so it's kind of graphic space. The terrain is slightly tilted to kind of exaggerate the distortion. The lights were all designed by us, black and white, matching the lines on the ground. They sit on the ceiling as if the dividers for the cars, but up on the ceiling of the car park. All the stations up to the Alps, up the mountains, kind of icebergs, steel frame, concrete base, which are open to the elements, so that it starts with the subway station and goes to a very steep hill, and then on the top of the mountain. A train station in Fragola and Naples, which is also on site, where the station itself is a bridge, so combining two things, the bridge and the station, over the rails. In Italy, you have it takes a long time to do things. They do it very well at the end. The concrete is really massaged. We're doing a ferry terminal also in Salerno. There's a project, I can't tell you where it is, but I can show you. It's the last project. It's an airport. Well, the idea of the kind of a petal or a flower extending to arms, showing all the kind of extensions of all the terminals on different layers. Just a glimpse of the interior of this enormous airport. Is that it? No, thank you very much. Thank you.
Zaha, thank you so much.
Thank you. I'm sorry. Somebody got the hint. It's now warmer.
Yeah, absolutely. We heard your very subtle.
I should have said something earlier, but I was too embarrassed.
So I think we're going to have many questions from the public. But before I get the questions here, I would like to tell you that as Brazilians, we thank you very much for you to finish with an airport that you don't know where it is, because we would love to have this airport in Brazil, definitely. Now, Zaha, I think that for all of us here, Brazilians, and who love your work for many years, I think it's marvelous to see that an architect that in the late 80s was sometimes accused of having drawings that were impossible to realize. And we see today the photographs of your realized projects, and they are more amazing than the drawings. And really, I'm at awe at your work, and I think that the public will agree with me. Now, I believe that the first thing I would like to tell you is that obviously we have here in Brazil a tradition because of Oscar Niemeyer that you mentioned in the beginning, and of all the generation of architects, to have very strong buildings in the paysage. And we feel in you something that you once said, that you come from a developing country, and in a developing country where you have lots of hope for the future, lots of optimism, and we recognize so much this thing in your work. So I want to know, when you come to Brazil, how do you feel about some optimism regarding the future of architecture and the things that can be done in a developing country like this one?
Well, I mean, you know, I think that Brazil in particular and other Latin American countries have a tremendous wealth in architecture. As I said, I came just from Mexico City, where they have really fantastic stuff. But here, you know, I mean, it's not. I mean, Oscar Niemeyer is great. I mean, I met many years ago Lucio Costa and Buddy Marx, and you know, some of the stuff here is so. And when I read like the museum and the kind of Algeresque project, there's some really great stuff here, but I suppose nothing much has happened in the last years. And so I think it could be a very exciting time for Brazil to, you know, to re-engage again in its identity. Because it was a very obvious, kind of very obvious effort in the 60s to invent an identity. And so I think it, you know, I think now life has changed and there's potential and there's resources to really make some amazing stuff.
We hope you will.
I'm sure you will.
Lots of them probably are here seeing your presentation, so we hope they will produce that. You know that in Brazil, the tradition, starting with the first modernist building in Brazil, which is the Ministry of Education, The tradition is that government is the great promoter of good architecture. You have the ministry, then you have Brasília, you have Pampulha, which was also a government-sponsored project. And in recent years, government cannot do that anymore because of legislation, because of many strange reasons, but the fact is that we can't do it anymore. So the private sector has an absolutely key role to do that. How can we stimulate the private sector, in your opinion, on really having a bigger role to do good architecture in a country like Brazil?
Well, I mean, I think that, if you think of, America was built, like New York and Chicago, most of the great buildings in these places were commercial developments. They were not necessarily cultural buildings. I mean, I'm talking about the Empire State Building or Inland Steel or any of these projects, or, you know, the Seagram Building. These are all privately owned projects. So there was, an ambition on part of the developers to also make great projects. I mean, but again, to go back to kind of the places like Singapore, where, you know, the government arranges a quango, which is like a company, but because they own the land, there is a unity, and you can implement a master plan to the site without having to kind of negotiate with every landowner. So I don't know what is the way forward, but I think there should be an incredible, ambition. Barcelona did it also, interestingly. They invited architects. The city invited architects to do a project, and then they found a developer to do them. Wasn't always successful, but I think that that's what they did. So I think it could be done, in this kind of public-private partnerships.
Yeah.
I mean, I think that I understand the ambition of the developer is to make a lot of money, and maybe the state ambition is to kind of create a cultural kind of facility or something else, but maybe they could be mediated.
Yeah.
You can make a bit of money, not necessarily a lot of money.
Absolutely. And it's funny, when we go to Beijing, you saw the building in Beijing, the Soho. You see the Soho of 10 years ago, they were not by good architects, and little by little they got better and better. Do you believe that in China they recognize that good architecture sells better commercial buildings?
Well, because, you know, I think the cities now in China are very competitive with each other. So not only the sites compete with each other, but the cities themselves, the second, third tier cities, they want to keep their young talent. So what is attracting these people to these cities is how much the city invests in its cultural facilities or housing or whatever. So I think there is a lot of competition between all these places.
Yeah, in Brazil, São Paulo tries to compete with Rio a lot. Now, I have two questions here, very good questions. The first one is, what is the starting point of your project? Where do you begin from?
There is no rule. No, well, somebody has to have an idea, sort of thing. Sometimes we don't have an idea, we just try many ideas till we come across one, but now we don't have the luxury of time to test out too many things. So that, you know, I think that, well, you have to also learn from your own repertoire, you know. Either you don't want to do something you've done before, or you know what works. So it depends. I mean, you start with an idea, I would say. And also, at the same time, look at all the different components, all the parameters which have an impact on that particular project. The scale, whatever, density, and stuff like that.
Well, another good question here is, as architecture is in a certain way a kind of reflection of society, where do you see your work in that?
Sorry, I didn't get that.
How do you see your work? Which society does your work reflect?
Well, I think, you know, the society, you know, I was a global society. You know, I don't think it's kind of, I don't think it's to do with ethnicity. I think it's to do or regionalism. People have similar ambitions. They go to similar schools. They look at similar, listen to similar music. But I think, you know, I think that people are more and more, I think since the 20th century, people, the population is more and more demanding about what they want. They, you're not catering only for a few people, you know, maybe a single private house, but when you are doing kind of cultural institutions, you have to offer it to a variety of people, because I always think that not everybody has the luxury to travel everywhere and see everything. And therefore, I think doing something amazing in their locale to inspire, whether it's good or, I mean, you know, it was amazing, like the ski jump. A lot of older couples go there to have tea, because they in all their life, they've never experienced seeing where the jumpers went, you know, or they have weddings, or... So I think by inserting just a simple room, which is a public room, you kind of immediately urbanize a kind of an activity which is only sport. And that's why I think cities are very important, because they don't rely only on a kind of single house or a single program. They have multiplicity of programs. They have many programs, and they're quite adjacent to each other. So people have the freedom to go in and out. It's like, you know, having everywhere a beach like in Rio, where everybody can go.
Yeah. There are three questions here on the same line. In which way do you take into consideration sustainability in your projects? Since I'm working on the preparation of Rio Plus 20, I have to say that the official United Nations definition of sustainability being the balance between the social, the environmental, and the economic dimensions of something. How would you define it in this
context? Well, I mean, I would say most offices are now kind of looking at this. There's a lot of research and studies on sustainability and, you know, the environment within buildings, how to cool, how to heat, how you can learn from existing kind of models of vernacular sometimes to make it work better. There's use of materials. I'm not a complete expert, but I mean, for example, even the way now the concrete is done is more sustainable or eco-friendly. And
very well. And two questions here on you worked with Rem Koolhaas, the influence of Rem Koolhaas on you, and when did Niemeyer start to be important for you?
Well, I think it's very kind of in the early, I mean, as I said, I think my first inspiration was really the Russian avant-garde, but to try to inject primitivism into architecture, one had to kind of revert back to certain modernist tendencies. And I think that both Rem and Oscar Niemeyer were very influential, but we also looked, I mean, of Corbu and Mies, and I mean, there were lots of, the Italian were all very influential in very different ways. And of course the Russians. The Russians were extremely influential. So I think it was a kind of composite influence. But I think that what began to occur maybe 20 years ago, first I think ideas of abstraction, and I was curious about Niemeyer's work because it was so abstract and pure, but at the same time using kind of the concrete to appropriately in terms of plasticity. And then later, I think in our own work, the discovery of topography and landscape was a very important discovery. It was no longer to do with architecture, but to do with kind of land formation and stuff like that.
One asks here that you introduce Patrick. They want to know how does it work, the creation among you and the architects that work in your office, and how many you have.
Where's Patrick?
You want to?
Patrick? He's gone. We spend all our time in London asking where Patrick is. There's Patrick. Come. The way we work is I say no, he says yes. I explained it yesterday, you know, he protects them from me. Because, you know, the generation which worked with me in the office for a long time, we were a small office, they suffered. So the new lot is a very, they have a good time. Now we are about 350 people, if not more. Many of the people in the office I've known for a long time. And yeah, they're kind of different degree, different relationships with each of, let's say, the clusters. Some people understand me, some people don't. Then I need Patrick to translate. But he also commands, you know, he hires many of his students, so he has complete authority over them.
So if you want a job, you know who to talk to.
But he is not critical, he just hires anybody. All you have to do is appear at the A bar or somewhere like that. Or outside the office door. It could be anything. Patrick will definitely hire you. But you know, you have to have a kind of, obviously, a good instinct about people. So, and many of them, as I said, some of them are students of mine from Vienna, and many of them are from the DRL program at the AA, which I think is a very good program. So they come to the office pre-trained, because they have a very similar kind of rigor in that program to the office.
Okay, so I think many people are interested in that, and there is an architecture student here that asks a very interesting question. He says, as an architecture student, I still don't know who I am or where I am as an architect. I wonder, when did you get the confidence and knowledge of your architecture language that is so unusual and unique?
Well, maybe in my fourth year. But I mean, I don't think it was very necessarily very developed. I'm obviously had a sort of moment of enlightenment. But I really think it's, you know, the only way to move forward is it's a hard work. You have to be very conscious of what you want to do, and just keep at it.
And do you think that this that young architects should wait for a certain number of years to, and not give up until when?
And they have to be very rigorous with their knowledge, and they have to have patience that it will eventually come. I mean, I can't promise. But I know from my experience with other people who are in my office and other people who are students of mine, the kind of incredible progress they made in their careers because of this diligence and hard work. There is no other trick. People think there are tricks, but it's short-lived.
Well, Mies had his first great project when he was more than 40, so lots of hope for everybody. Another question, finally, which is on your creation. You start with drawings. When does the computer enter, And a very practical question, which softwares are you using for the preparation of your projects?
Well, I even if I sketch now, they don't understand what I'm doing. They're really, I mean, I think there are people who are very, very talented. I mean, I do miss drawing, but I think there are people who are very talented on the computer in terms of just generating ideas. Patrick knows all the programs. Patrick.
Patrick, go on, reveal that.
Well, we're using everything, basically. There's literally. But for different phases, we're using different tools. Of course, we're using Maya and Rhino, and a lot of scripting, and MelScript and Grasshopper now, I think, is very important. So this is an extremely important skill to develop. And then, of course, we're also trying to gear up on the downstream realization in terms of BIM modeling with Revit and digital projects. So you have to take in everything.
Very well. Some of these softwares are on sale outside. So the last question before I ask you something, which is on the production of your architecture, and we see that in many of the cases you are building in isolated sites or not very close to historical sites. How do you feel apart from the Rome case, no? On a historical and cultural site, have you had projects that were asked for you, a cultural site near a historical site? How would you react to that? Would there be some kind of contextualism?
Well, I think, for example, the Rome project, I think, is a very, very contextual, not in terms of its appearance, but in terms of the geometry on the site. So I think you can. I mean, actually, the work actually does stem from a observation of existing historic cities. It doesn't necessarily, it didn't stem from a kind of a modernist city or like a New York situation. They were very kind of site specific. So I think the idea of context in the last 20, 30 years changed. Is no longer about contemporaneity in terms of kind of material or kind of form, but it's more about the site conditions. So I think you can, actually it's very exciting to build next to a historic center, but I mean you have to also understand how you to do it.
Very well. So, Zaha, I'm going to ask you a last thing before we close. If you can say a few words about your feelings being here in Rio. You've been for a few days. You know the country. You came before here. What are your feelings about Brazil as not only as architecture, but in a general way? And what message would you like to give to most of those here? Although they are in the dark, they are most of them very young.
Well, I think, you know, I think Rio is an amazing city, but I can detect that it requires some new things because in this day and age, let's say, because I go to China a lot, the change is very rapid in these places. So one is almost accustomed to change, and I think that, you know, for whatever, you know, on one hand, it's nice that it has not been nothing, not everything has been eradicated, but I think maybe it needs to have some new things. Also, I think Rio has changed. I mean, there's more traffic. It feels much safer. It's more civil. You know, I mean, when I first came here, it was a very different story 25 years ago, 20 years ago, even 14 years ago. So there's, it seems like a kind of a, it's much more calm and more pleasant as a city to be in, but I think it does need some new interventions. I don't know what they are, but I'm sure they will be happening.
Very good. So, Zaha, we all thank you, I think, a lot. Good night.
Thank you. Thank you.